For some of you, it's the afternoon. For me, it's still the morning. Hi, guys!
Hi!
Hi, Dr. Nick! Hi, everybody!
Hi!
Excellent! Well done! You guys look fantastic! Yay! Thank you all for coming today. Some of us are very hungover. So my lesson for the day is eat dinner before you drink martinis. I'm Mary Elizabeth McGlynn, and I am the director, a voice director of Cowboy Bebop. Thank you all for coming. I also played Julia because I became obsessed with Spike. We are here today. Let me introduce this unbelievable cast. So, without further ado, in the role of Edward, the beautiful and alluring Melissa Fahn. We've got to do selfies for sure. The illustrious and gorgeous and amazing and fantastic as Faye, Wendee Lee. As master chef of bell peppers and beef.
Yeah.
Sans beef. The amazing and fantastic, all J.J. Abrams actually let him off set today so that he could be here, as Jet Beau Billingslea. And everybody's favorite space cowboy. My personal favorite, no offense guys, sorry. As Spiker, Steve Blum.
Right up, space cowboy.
Now you know what a space cowboy rides.
Just taking pictures of each other.
Oh, this is awkward.
What was amazing is that in this series that was short-lived and beautifully so, there was one episode that only had the main cast in it. Luckily enough, it is called Toys in the Attic. Although Laura Bailey did tweet that maybe we should read Flowers in the Attic. And then Marisha Ray tweeted we should read Flowers for Algernon. But I think we'll go with Toys in the Attic. Yes. All right, you want to do this, guy?
Yeah!
BS, my part.
Bullshit, my line.
BS, Jen.
All right.
Edward.
Only thing that's important. Okay, Cowboy Bebop, this is episode 11, Toys in the Attic. Something is making its way through the bowels of the spaceship Bebop. It's dark. We see cobwebs. We hear a squishy sound. It's scary. Title card, session 11, Toys in the Attic. The Bebop is floating silently in space. Ein, the data dog, is napping. Ed is also napping.
Space travel log 0968.
into time. Sounds good to call bounty hunting freelance work, but all that really means is that we're self-employed. So when there's no one to hunt, we have nothing. Nothing to do, nothing to live on. Well, that's all part of the life we've chosen. Our destiny, if you like, but when you're out of money, you start thinking about quick cash.
Title card, lesson one, cut to Spike, putting on a gas mask. He loads a gun with some kind of canister. Faye and Jet are gambling. She holds some dice in one hand and a cup in the other.
All right, you're fine with both of these now, right?
With a quick flick of her wrist, she slams the cup down on the board covering the dice.
Even.
You're going with even?
Reveal on Jet, who is topless. He's lost his shirt.
No, make it odd.
Elsewhere, we see the earlier gun shooting out flames. It's being used to cook some kebabs.
Odd, you're sure?
Yes, odd.
Snake eyes, even.
Oh, man.
I can't eat anymore.
I'd actually prefer payment in cash. I'm not a pawn shop, you know. Well, Jet?
Jet is wearing nothing but boxers. He stands up.
A man keeps his word.
Spike walks in with the cooked kebabs.
Huh? I smell cooked kebabs and smelly shorts.
Jet's boxers float past Spike's face.
And that's why I told you not to play against her. Biting the kebab, not the shorts.
That was last night.
Yes, it was. That same something is still running through some part of the ship. More cobwebs, more scary sounds. A rat notices this something and runs off terrified. Ein hears something through the vent. He whines.
Humans were meant to work and sweat to earn a living, after all. Those that try to get rich quick or live at the expense of others all get divine retribution somewhere along the way. That's the lesson. Unfortunately, we quickly forget the lessons we've learned, and then we have to learn them all over again.
Jet is in the stockroom of the ship. He finds a blanket and wraps himself in it.
Oh, damn it. I don't remember that. A refrigerator way back here?
Back to the point of view of the scary something running through the ship. It seems to have made its way to the upper levels, and there are no more cobwebs, but it's still scary.
Boom.
Survival of the fittest is the law of nature. We deceive or are deceived. Thus we flourish or perish. Nothing good ever happened to me when I trusted others. That is the lesson.
Title card, lesson two.
So, how much did you swindle?
A word like that could damage my reputation. He just had a run of bad luck.
Ah, right. He just didn't know about that anklet.
That's part of the skill of the game.
You could at least give him his clothes back, Faye.
I'll rent them to him.
Greedy, aren't we?
Well, I prefer to think of it as enterprising.
An alarm goes off.
Huh?
Spike and Faye start running. They are followed by Ein. They find Jet, who's rubbing the back of his neck.
Hey, what happened?
Something bit me.
What do you mean by something?
Ein starts growling menacingly at something. It puts the crew of the Bebop on edge. Turns out it's just a rat.
Oh.
It wasn't a rat, okay? Look at this. There's a weird mark on my neck.
Well, that was a waste of time. Sheesh.
Spike, it happened near that old refrigerator.
Refrigerator?
Yeah, you got any ideas?
Maybe. There was a... Nope, I can't remember.
Ina is staring at a corner, growling. suddenly stops, looks around, and then leaves with everyone else. As Faye is walking back, she senses something is following her. She turns around, but there's nothing there. Close-up shot on Tiger Balm.
Jets.
You sure this is gonna work?
No, it works on everything but nearsightedness and cavities.
Then it works on the athlete's foot?
Yeah, sure.
Don't you have anything, like, real medicine that's just for sores and wounds?
That would be this.
Spike holds up a dried lizard.
That heals wounds?
Yep. You just squish it up and boil it in 3 cups of water, and when it turns green and goopy, you drink it.
Spike, is there something more, you know, different?
Oh, yeah, I got it.
Yeah, give me that.
Spike holds up a dried scorpion.
I'll take the other thing.
Ein's in a corridor going crazy barking and running in circles. Back to Spike and Jet. Spike is pouring some goopy green liquid into a glass that Jet is holding, and Jet looks scared.
Oh, great. I'm feeling a lot sicker than I did before. Do I look pale or what?
You're always pale.
Faye enters.
What is that awful smell?
Herbal medicine.
Herbal medicine? That swill? Smells like day-old roadkill soured and soaked in soured milk and maggot juice.
Yeah, more like rotten soybeans and turpentine.
Yeah, you're right.
That's enough. I gotta drink this stuff.
He gets up the courage and then downs the drink with big gulps. Jet collapses, he falls forward, and as if he's passed out.
Oh, brother.
Come on, quit joking around. Huh?
Spike notices something strange on the back of Jet's neck, where he claimed to have been bitten. It's ugly and purplish. It looks bad and infected. Jet is now laid up on the couch. Spike is typing furiously on the computer doing some research. They're running analysis on something.
So it was a rat, right? I mean, this is no big deal. Am I wrong?
I have no clue. He got some kind of poison that's not in the database. I'm checking into some similar toxins. Cryptos, polycium, no, that's not it. Cholera? Nah, it's not that. Ebola virus. Nope. Bifidobacterium? Nah, not even close.
So, then what is it?
Ein starts barking again.
Ein, give it a rest, would you?
Well, it's not an ordinary rat. Ein, keep quiet.
So what could it be, then?
Well, it's,
Ed leaps down from out of nowhere.
A mystery space creature! Spooky, the attack of the horrible alien.
Well, yeah, that is possible, I suppose. Yeah, right.
Then what is it? It's not in the database, right?
Well, it...
Look! These base pairs are abnormal.
Huh. You think so?
Ed has never seen this before. So what else could it be but a horrible alien, huh? What?
Maybe it's, I don't know, something like a rat went through a mutation and evolved and turned into some kind of unusual creature and secreted this new form of mysterious poison.
Oh, well, that's brilliant. Right up there with Ed's theory that it's horrible aliens. I mean, really pitiful.
Ein barks.
Aya! What are we gonna do, Ein? You believe it's a horrible alien, don't you? It's spooky.
The scary something is traveling through the ship. This time it's in the vents. We see spooky shots from its point of view. Through the vent, we can see Faye taking a bath. Hello. Cut to Faye in the bathroom, reading while taking a bath. It's a bubble bath, so all her naughty bits are all strategically covered. Something goopy falls from the vent.
Huh?
Faye decides it's nothing, goes back to reading.
All right. This locates and monitors heat sources.
Sorry, my pages got stuck together. Spike is explaining how an electronic device works. Ed is wearing some crazy goggles, which are attached to this device. Spike is also wearing one of these devices.
We usually use it when we're tracking down bounty heads that have gone into hiding. Can you see me?
We see Spike in thermal view. We also see Ayn, who's standing next to him.
Whoa, yeah!
That's fine. I'm gonna test it now. Don't move till I tell you.
Spike looks up to see a thermal view of Ed running off chasing Ayn. They disappear.
Ayn, where are you going?
Hey, wait! Hey!
Via Spike's thermal view, we see a blobby thing with a heat source moving around the room.
Well, this is weird. Did it break?
Faye runs in wearing a bathrobe, panting.
What's the matter? Did you find something?
Okay, the theory you had about a mutant creature or something, remember?
Yeah.
Okay, what happens if you're bitten by that?
Well, I can't say for sure until I catch one and examine it, but I can guess.
Death. No, please. Why did it have to be this way? I still have a lot to live for. I haven't committed any crimes. At least no really bad ones yet. I'm still young and full of life.
Full of what?
Life. It's just so unfair. Poor me!
Get over it! No, that's not what it says. Hey, come on, what's this all about?
Spike notices a purplish, ugly infection like the one Jet had on Faye's leg. Cut to the scary something. It's still moving through the ship. The cobwebs are back, and yes, still scary. Eye catch, Cowboy Bebop. Ed is walking through the ship with Ayn.
August 6th, Sky Day. Today, Ed goes looking for the spooky, mysterious, horrible alien.
Title card, lesson 3.
Lesson, if you see a stranger, follow him.
Ed passes by the bathroom. She opens the door and sticks her head inside.
Where are you? Are you here? Mr. Spooky Space Creature.
Meanwhile, elsewhere on the ship.
Ed, Ayn. Hey, this isn't hide and seek, dammit.
Ed has left the bathroom, is walking through a hall with Ayn.
Exploration, experimentation, exploration, exclamation. I will come back alive. I trust you, Ed.
She jumps and hangs on the bar like a monkey. She flips so she's now hanging upside down like a monkey.
Ayn!
She notices Ayn's walking away.
Are you here? Hello? Answer me! Oh, man.
Ayn's walking by himself over a grate, sniffing it. He suddenly stops and notices something. Something drops on top of Ayn, and we hear big, scary music. We hear Ayn yelp loudly.
Ayn? Ed? Where are you?
Spike puts on his thermal goggles. He sees something on the grate above him. It's giving off heat. He climbs up to see what it is. It's Ayn. He has the same ugly purplish mark on his back.
Ayn? Hey, hang in there. Where's Ed? I can't believe they got you. Where are your animal instincts? Huh?
Spike puts on the thermal goggles. He sees something blobby down the corridor that's giving off heat moving toward him. He picks up Ayn and starts backing up slowly. Then he breaks out into a full run. Cut to now. Jet, Faye, and Ayn are all laid up ill. Spike stands over them.
No choice. Gotta go in.
Spike shoves a clip in his gun, loads the blowtorch, puts some explosives on a utility belt. He's gearing up to do some major fighting. He grabs his thermal tracking device and a fencing foil. There's a piece of meat skewered on the foil. He takes a bite. Currently in cruise mode on Route 66. Approximate cruise time remaining, 82 hours. Spike is programming something into the computer, preparing to enter full autopilot. After passing the gate, the ship is pre-programmed to land on Mars. The route cannot be changed once this is confirmed.
Ed, are you in here? Hey!
Spike notices the thermal tracker he gave Ed abandoned on the floor.
Huh? Must have gotten her too.
Spike continues his search. Some goop drops from the ceiling, nearly hitting Spike. It's not the scary creature goop. It's just normal goop.
Duh. Don't scare me like that.
As Spike gets out a cigarette, we see some blobby thing drop from the ceiling behind him. It scurries off. He turns around, guns in hand.
That's it!
He shoots at it and misses. The blob flies at him. Spike falls over.
Come on!
Spike throws a gas bomb on the blob and runs out of a portal, sealing it in a section of the ship. He pants. He searches for a lighter to relight his cigarette, but he can't find it, so he ends up using a blowtorch. After his smoke, he opens up the portal, goes back to check on it to see if the blob is dead. Another second later, Spike comes running out, being chased by the blob.
Bang! Let's go, slime ball.
Spike corners the slime ball and torches it until it stops moving. He approaches it slowly to get a better look.
This thing smells kind of familiar.
Spike's stomach growls. He remembers the rest of his kebab.
I guess I should have eaten that stuff. Well, I'm sure it's still in the fridge. Whoa. That was when I remembered everything. It was, about 1 year ago. I'd gotten a hold of a real Ganymede rock lobster. I hid it in the fridge in the stockroom so no one else would eat it. But I had forgotten about it and left it there for a whole year. Wonder what it looks like in there now.
Spike approaches the fridge in the stockroom. He puts his hand on one handle of the door, about to open it. There's fear in his eyes. Cue creepy music. He opens the fridge and it's filled with gooey, goopy, gross-looking overgrowth. Spike sets the ship's alarm and turns off the gravity system within the ship. He pushes the heavy fridge out of the stockroom towards one of the cargo bay holds. He's about to release the fridge into outer space when he sees the blob on the side of the fridge. It jumps at Spike and attacks his arm.
Ah, shit! Oh, that's great.
Since Spike hasn't opened the hatch yet, the fridge bounces against it and the fridge door knocks open. It rebounds off the hatch and starts heading towards him.
Ah!
Spike releases the hatch and the fridge gets sucked outside. He holds on to the railing, trying not to get sucked out as well. He reaches out for the controls to close the hatch again. Flicks the switch, the hatch starts to close slowly. Spike continues to hold on, waiting for it to completely seal, but the purplish mark on his hand makes him weak. He loses his grip and falls toward the hatch, which is still slightly open, but it closes just in the nick of time. An unconscious Spike floats through the cargo bay.
So, that's the story. And what was the real lesson? Don't leave things in the fridge.
Elsewhere on the ship, Ed wakes up from a nap. We see blurry, groggy vision from her point of view. Something is approaching her. It's the blob.
More pudding!
Ed picks up the blob and eats it.
I can't eat anymore.
We see various shots of Faye, Jet, Spike, and Ein floating in zero gravity as we hear Tchaikovsky's Waltz of the Flowers play in the background. The fridge also twirls and dances through outer space, spewing its contents out in beautiful ribbons. The end.
But thanks for your support. That was the last episode. May they all rest in peace. Amen. And for the next series, we bring you Cowgirl Ed. Ed is the main character.
Hey, wait a minute.
What kind of selfish thing is that?
Next episode, Jupiter Jazz Part 1.
There really is a next episode.
The end!
The end! The end!
Makes me kind of weepy to hear that again.
Brings brings back some feels, don't it?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, it does.
We're all warm and fuzzy up here.
Wow.
Yes.
Let's do it again.
Yeah.
Yes.
This time,
I get to play Jet.
That's right. I'll do it in character voices.
Well, I'll play Ed.
And I'll play with the director.
No, wait, what?
That's why we're separated.
Bang.
Bang, yeah, bang.
So, you guys have any questions? We've got a mic right here, and I think we've got time to answer some stuff.
Yeah.
So come on over and ask something.
Come on up.
Come on up.
Yeah. Go for it.
Hi.
Most of us won't bite.
So I just had one thing about the movie. There's like a theory going around that the whole thing is actually just Spike's dream.
Oh.
What do you guys think about that?
Oh, I like it.
I'm totally on board on that.
Whatever happens, happens.
Yeah, that sounds cool.
Yeah.
Well, it's a theory because it's a theory. It's up to you. A lot of things in the show were really meant to be left to your interpretation. That was the director's intention.
Yeah. As long as there's more, I'm on board.
I'm just glad you care.
Exactly right. Yeah.
Yeah.
So I asked you guys earlier, but I'd like to ask you three. Of course, it's obviously a bit stereotypical for a guy dressed up as a Jedi to ask, but if you guys could take part as your own role in any version of Star Wars as a voice actor, what character would you prefer to play?
To play any character in,
yeah,
in Star Wars?
Yeah,
we just want to be in the bar as the Bebop.
Yeah, in the space bar. Yeah.
No,
yeah.
Can't see it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Just the whole Bebop gang in the space bar. I'm there. Pardon us.
That's the quietest actors ever are.
Yeah, it's pretty meta, though. It's pretty meta.
No, that's a cool question. I don't know. I just like us all hanging in a bar. And...
We're the band in the cantina
the
bar.
Band. That would be great.
That would be great. That would be great.
And I'll be singing, Bebop-a-loo-a, yo mama, baby.
Yeah.
Bebop-a-loo-a.
Thank you.
Oh, yeah. Thanks.
Over the course of the series, what was, like, the most emotionally wrenching scene for you to do?
Oof. That's easy for me. It was Speak Like a Child, getting Feifei's background and finding out she had so much she had repressed that made her the hard-shell exterior Feifei that we know. We were just talking about that this morning, how living with a character for several episodes, knowing there was something underlying deeply troubling going on with the character, made her more complex and flawed and interesting and relatable. So that was really profound for me, finding out that she was extremely vulnerable underneath that hard surface. Yeah.
Finding out there's no beef. That was very disappointing.
Yeah, I had a very demanding crew. They wanted beef in their bell peppers and beef.
For me, it was in the movie when Spike was in the cell opposite Elektra, and he had to recall his lost love. And it was the first truly emotional scene I had to portray as an actor. And it took some doing to get me there. It was really hard for me to get that vulnerable. And I was used to playing big, crazy creatures and big, broad characters, but it was a very nuanced piece, and Mary very delicately guided me through that and taught me how to do that part of acting in that session.
Yay, Mary.
You were amazing.
You taught me. That's my teacher right there. That's...
Dope.
I sense it. Sensei.
Yeah, sensei. Oh, stop. You're right. Oh, stop.
No,
you're
that's
absolutely
true.
Right. Oh, stop.
Even if I wasn't madly in love with her, I'd say that.
Well, for Jet, as when he goes back and to his old love and his, you know, that life that he went back, that there was a wonderful monologue that was written for him, and that was his most vulnerable time, I think, in the show.
What episode?
And I think for me, when Edward had to make the choice to leave, and you know, it was her father, right? That and But when she made that choice to leave the Bebop crew, I mean, that just says it all when she's walking away, and that was...
That particular one, that kind of really gets to me when I watch it, because, like, from that point forward, trajectory of, like, things that went course with the rest of the crew, it was like, she left at the perfect time.
Takes a genius, right, babe?
Right? You know, right, man?
Sure. Right, man?
Sure.
Well, I've got kind of an odd question just about voice acting as a whole. I do a bit of stage acting. I come from a very, you know, theater-oriented family, and so I've been in Shakespeare, things like that. And one thing we rely a lot in that is, you know, other people that we can work off of, set, costumes that really give you the vibe of, like, oh, I'm this character. And I know you're just in a booth with microphone, script, and occasionally, if you're lucky, from what I've heard, other people that'll be in maybe separate booths or the same booth with you. So I just wanted to ask you guys, what's something that you guys do to kind of help mentally get yourself into a character or to, like, really engross yourself in the world, since you only have such, like, a limited variety of just things that you can do to really picture what the world is like, whether it's picking the brain of the director or just reading through the script and trying to look at things, or maybe there's screenshots, things like that. So just wanted to ask you about what it's like for that.
Well, I'll start. Well, I think a lot of us, I think all of us, with the acceptance of, with the exception, I'm sorry, I can't speak, of Steve, who has a gold lame background, but we all have theater background. But you come from a performing background too, where you were a musician and performed for many years, but we all have a theater and live performance background. And so we can also draw upon that when we go in the booth. I know I do, and you know, when you see a character, sometimes we don't know our characters until we get right in the booth. I think that is always the case, except if you're on a long-running show and you've been doing your character over and over for several weeks or months. But, you know, for me, and especially on this show, there was great physicality in Edward. There was all this fluidity. There was music in her voice. And I was able to draw upon a lot of those things that I come from dance, from theater, from music, and to use all those different elements to bring this little character to life. And we had such great direction. And you gave us such great freedom, Mary, to really explore. So with this show in particular, and I think a lot of other shows, you know, I want to see what their physicality is and how do they stand, and are they slumped over, or is their head hanging down, or are they up and are they bubbly, or are they, you know, whatever the character traits are. As soon as I get to see that character, it opens up so much for me as a voice actor.
It's a visual medium. We're recreating performances, so we're able to see a final product and then rebuild it in another language. So really, it's very, very visual, and then referencing what we're hearing in the Japanese, working with the script, all of those things come together quickly, and it's better to be not prepared for that, but to be an open palette, ready to play, and let your director really guide you through that.
And I think to be a good actor in this medium, you have to be childlike. You have to refer back to that time when you're in a sandbox and using your imagination. And not only am I childlike, I'm childish, so that helped too. And without the training, I started in anime, so I was used to being in a booth by myself with the director. That's all I knew. I didn't do stage, I didn't have that kind of training, so I didn't know to rely on the other actors for that. I relied completely on my director to give me the context, and the rest of it is just playtime. It was really just being in that sandbox as a little kid again, and just imagining when I see the words on the page, when you're reading a comic book or, you know, a book, you're gonna have these images come up in your head, and that's all it is for me. That's the way I've always worked. So it's playtime, and that's something that a lot of people just don't do enough of in their life as they become adults. And we're really fortunate that we get to be childlike for a career. It's wonderful, and you can apply that to anything, really.
Right, yeah. And I my approach is a traditional character development, you know, as an actor, and finding in myself what is consistent with the character. And as been mentioned before, so often we don't know, unless we've been doing a show for a while, to develop that character, we don't know. And so we have to go in as an open slate, as was stated, and to use our imagination and play, as Steve said. You know, I mean, that's what we do. We use our imagination and we play.
Yeah, Play hard.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
We only have 10 minutes, they say, so maybe we'll do a quick lightning round.
Lightning round, okay.
So I was wondering if any of you have a favorite song from the series and if the music affected your performance.
So much.
Blue's my favorite. We actually we got to sing it together in Hawaii. Steve learned it on the ukulele. Melissa.
I kind of picked up some background.
Yes. Stuff at the end, so that was...
They were beautiful. Did you bring the ukulele, you guys?
No.
Oh, well, the sun has it.
Oh, that's right. If anybody has a ukulele, we can do blue.
I don't remember how to play it.
Yeah, I don't know if we have time to do that.
Go ahead. Okay, next question. Quickly. Thank you, great question.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi, Ed.
You can pull it down. There you go.
I'm not sure if I can ask or not, but I was wondering if... I'm worried and Jet could like do a voice acting. Like there's an episode where Edward's really hungry, and I guess she's complaining she's hungry, and then she wants to eat mine. So I was gonna ask if Edward and Jet could, I guess, kind of role play that, but instead of Jet yelling at Edward, can you yell at, like, say, Kayla? Oh no, Edward, don't eat Ayn, something like that.
Wow.
Your name is Kayla?
It's Kayla.
So, Kayla, you're going to eat Ayn? Is that what you want to do? You want to eat Ayn? There are laws. I'm not sure, but I think that might be a little animal abuse or something.
And just so you know, he tastes nasty. I've tried it.
Yeah. Well, a dog like that, you don't eat all at once. You just take little nibbles.
Be careful which end you start at.
Yeah.
You got that and a lot more, girl.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you.
For Wendee, I think Faye's at the conclusion of Cowboy Bebop, Faye has the most open-ended ending. I was wondering if you could comment on what you hope Faye does after the conclusion, and maybe if different, what Faye actually does.
That's so hard. We were talking about that this morning, and you know, I just think I hold out for Spike coming out of the other end of that big burst of fire, and many characters live on, and we move on to the next season.
Mm-hmm. and Faye continues her life of crime.
Well, she keeps her way is that she gets all the money.
Yeah.
And then Edward comes back, and Faye teaches her all about the birds and the bees.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks.
Hello.
Hi.
So, thank you guys for coming. This means a lot to all of us. So for years, there's been rumors that Keanu Reeves is going to play Spike in a live-action movie. If you could cast the movie, which actors and actresses would play your respective characters?
It's so hard. We've talked about this before. Yeah.
Well, I play Jet.
That's a given.
I actually had a conversation with Keanu about this. I met him in an airport, and it was the craziest thing. This was a few years ago, and because I was curious, like you guys were, as to what his take was on it. And he was studied up on it. He had watched the whole series. He loved it. He was a big, big part of the possibility of that actually coming to fruition. But he said that the script was amazing, but it would have cost $500 million to produce. And his biggest fear was that he was going to be too old to do his own stunts by the time it got greenlit. So I think he would have been a really interesting choice for it.
Actually, I do too.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I think his performance in John Wick sold me.
Yeah. He changed my mind.
I just love that he had so much respect. He has so much respect for it, which I really, really appreciate.
Yeah.
I'm a huge Keanu fan. I love him.
Yeah,
he's great.
Thank you.
All right, thank you.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hi.
If you could play on any other character in the show, who would you play?
Any one of them.
Any one of them.
Yeah.
Well, you got a good leg up on it. You know?
I just want to switch costumes. Let's put Jet in Faye's costume.
Yeah.
I'd like to see that.
I've seen some man Faye's, but come on.
Jet Faye.
Man Faye.
Wow.
Okay.
Wow.
Oh,
thank you.
Thank you.
I think you could rock it.
Okay, I can now cross 5 things off my bucket list.
Very cool.
Okay, at this convention, I'm finding out that some of you have also been directing. Guess I came here imperfectly prepared. Mary, Melissa, anyone else I may have missed, if you're both directing and acting, which one are you trending to? Which one do you prefer? Why?
I'm not directing, but these two love me.
Sorry,
that's okay.
I think the more I direct, the better an actor I become, and the more I'm directed by amazing directors, they enhance each other. I think it's a really nice relationship. You know, one, when I'm, you know, I'm so hungover, I can't even put words together. I defer to Wendee. But yeah, I love them both, and I think they one enhances the other. So the more acting I do, the better director I become. The more directing I do, hopefully the better actor I become. So.
It's more hours at the wheel. It's just more hours in the studio, and the more time that we spend being challenged by what we love, the better it enhances the things that we do and our skill set. So very much the case. I mean, I haven't really studied a lot with as far as an actor goes, but I feel like all of my directors are coaches that I've had one-on-one studying with, you know, that I've been able to gain great skill by the time that you spend. And being immersed in this medium has just given us a great time to specialize in it. So it's really fun to be able to have diversity. That's the thing I love the most, playing roles one day, directing another day, preparing a script, producing or viewing a final mix, singing, anything that we can do to kind of add our mark to it and be a part of the production is what I love most.
Thank you.
Hi, guys.
Hi.
You're all super cool, I think. I mean, I don't know you, but I'm guessing you're pretty cool.
Yeah, you're right.
Well,
at least me, I'm, you know.
JJ says.
Okay, so my question was, how often do you get to know the character enough that you like to feel confident enough to like improvise them or something, or if it's often, if there are any times where you have trouble getting into character?
Well, improvising is pretty limited because we're dubbing the video is already there, and so that makes it a bit difficult because we have to meet the flaps.
I think if I can interject, like with my character, there was in the original animation and with the original voicing in Japan, they played a lot with Edward. So we got to improvise to fill the right spaces. So we might not have done exactly what the original Japanese voice did, but we made it our own and improvised within that framework, which was a blast.
Yeah.
Awesome. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi.
Hello.
I guess I'm the last question.
No. Oh, yeah.
Basically, yeah.
Make it a good one.
No pressure.
No pressure.
Every time I have a friend that recommends me anime, Cowboy Bebop is always on that list. So I guess it's like a kind of a two-parter. How does it feel to be part of something that is pretty much quintessential in anime as a whole? And do you think that this anime will withstand time as years go by and it will still just be as important as it is now?
I think it has. I mean, the fact that we recorded this 17 years ago and we're here now is 14 or 15. Yeah, so 15 years ago. Yeah.
Incredible.
And I feel like, you know, I now have people coming up and saying, I'm showing this to my kids. I saw it when I was, you know, 15, and now it's just unbelievable. It's an unbelievable show. And I think it is a gateway to anime for a lot of people because it's so westernized. And I mean, the episode we just read is basically a mashup of Alien and 2001. It's beautiful. And that's Watanabe. I mean, he did a genius job at this storytelling. So I think they will be. I think it will be, you know, stand the test of time forever, I hope.
Well, and for the other part of that question, it's humbling. I mean, it's really humbling to be part of something like that. And we didn't know that going in, that it was going to become this. But I think what really makes this even more humbling to me is that we all cared a lot. And even on the shows, I know these guys now, they're my family. Yeah. And I know that they care about everything they do. It doesn't matter how big the part it is. It doesn't matter how crappy the show is. They're going to give everything they have to it. And just the fact that we all cared so much about the project makes it that much more meaningful for us at this stage. And so humbled that you guys care now.
Oh, yeah.
So thank you guys for caring so much.
Really. Thank you so much. Thank you.
An announcement. These scripts are, we have all signed them. And these will be for, we're going to put these in the auction.
Charity.
So it'll go to charity, but please bid on these.
What is the charity? Do we
what's
know what
the charity?
Charity
is?
We don't know what the charity is.
It's a really good charity.
It's
going
to keep people from eating data dogs.
Yes.
Because they're law.
The charity is Beau and Associates.
One more quick announcement. I think we're all cool with this. We're going to take a couple of minutes. We don't have time to take individual photos, so it's not going to be lining up, go, go, go. But what the cast has agreed to do is to come up to the edge of the stage here, and whoever wants to come up and just take a big group shot of them.
Like three minutes max.
Yeah, we can do that. And then we will be showing Cowboy the Bebop, the movie here. Also, remember, there will be an autograph session tonight at 6:30. 6:30 tonight in the autographs area up on the mezzanine. So anyone at this time, photos.
Thank you. Thank you. I love your comedy shirt.
Thank you. Always comedy.
Yes. You might use wasted.
Yeah. I didn't hear much of it.
I took this picture. I only sent Liz one picture.
Once again, guys, 3 minutes. 3 minutes time limits. The 3 minutes starts now. So countdown for 3 minutes at this point. Thank you.